Hello, I'm Kirsty Young, and this is a podcast from the Desert Island Discs archive. For rights reasons, we've had to shorten the music. The programme was originally broadcast in 1978, and the presenter was Roy Plumley.
Our castaway this week is Britain's first prospective woman Prime Minister, the leader of Her Majesty's opposition, the Right Honourable Margaret Thatcher. Now, Mrs. Thatcher, how important to you is music?
It's what I go to when I want to take refuge in something completely different, when I really want to get away from worries and go from the very logical life that I've lived and I've always been trained to live, really to a different depth of experience.
You play the piano, don't you?
Yes, but I don't play any longer. I didn't get time enough to practice, and I couldn't bear hearing myself play badly. Or what happens to you after a time is you never learn anything new. Mm-hmm. You go on playing the things which you learned as a young person and never play anything new. So I'm afraid I just don't play at all now. One day when I've retired, I'll take it up again.
You used to sing, too?
Not solo parts. All my family were musical. My father had a lovely bass voice, and therefore we were accustomed to singing at home. We had to make our own entertainment and amusements in those days, and we did. So I used to join choirs, and I joined the Bach choir when I was at Oxford and loved it.
Well, now to the records. What shall we hear first?
Well, I'm going to play first the one that I always go to first if I get to the country for the weekend and I just want to get away from politics. I go straight to the record player and I put on the Emperor Concerto, Beethoven.
The closing passage of Beethoven's Emperor Concerto, Alfred Brendel as soloist with the London Philharmonic Orchestra, directed by Bernard Haitink. How well could you manage in a practical sense as a castaway? Did you ever go camping?
No, I haven't had much experience of camping. And I just am a little bit worried about how I'm going to manage, but I am pretty practical.
You could put up some kind of shelter, you think?
Oh, I think so. I do like doing things with my hands. Mm-hmm. So I think I would just about be all right. I'm quite a fast learner.
Would you try to escape?
I don't think so, because a desert island just all sounds very much of an island. And I'm cautious by nature. And I would just hope that someone would come and rescue me. My dreams would go that way.
I'm sure they will. Record number two.
Record number two, I've chosen a brass band. You know, they played quite a large part in my youth. We loved them. And I thought that I would like to hear something like Going Home.
Thank you. Going Home from Dvorak's New World Symphony, played by the GOS Footwear Band. You were born in Grantham in Lincolnshire. A small town, isn't it?
A small town. Yes, very much a community there, living in a town where everyone knew everyone else. Mm. I loved it.
And you lived in a flat above your father's grocer shop.
That's right.
Right on the Great North Road.
Right on the Great North Road.
You weren't an only child, were you?
No, fortunately. I have an older sister, for which I'm eternally grateful. You know, blood is thicker than water. When you've got problems, there's nothing like close relatives.
You've described your upbringing as rather Puritan.
Well, it was very strict. We went to church twice on Sundays and to Sunday school twice. We were never allowed any amusements on Sundays. We did have people in and we talked. I think wartime changed our ideas quite a lot because you had to do all sorts of different things on Sundays. But I can remember, I think the toughest thing of my childhood was that my father taught me very firmly indeed, you do not follow the crowd because you're afraid of being different.
Mm-hmm.
You decide what to do yourself. If necessary, you lead the crowd, but you never just follow. Oh, it was very hard indeed, but my goodness me, it stood me in good stead.
And you went to the grammar school. Did you win a scholarship?
Yes.
Which subjects interested you most?
I was a fairly good all-rounder and had difficulty in choosing which side I went on, the science side or the arts side. And in those days, you know, you decided at about the age of 15, soon after you'd done your matriculation, and you took all science subjects or all arts subjects. I can tell you what decided me, and I'm sure it's been the same with a lot of young people. We had a marvellous chemistry teacher, a wonderful teacher and a wonderful person. And I'm sure that that decided me to take chemistry, which I did.
During the holidays, did you help in the shop sometimes?
Oh, yes. Yes, and this is where one learned to see and talk to so many people and talk easily. I loved it. There were always people coming in. And my father was a local councillor, and they'd often come in to have a word with him about something.
As you said, your father was a councillor and also an alderman, and he became mayor. He called himself an independent. To which side did his politics veer?
Well, they were conservative, but in those days, you know, we didn't fight local councils as party politicians. Mm. It wasn't the done thing. But we always helped the conservative candidate, and I can remember my first experience of politics was the 1935 election. I was only 10, but I do remember it very vividly. And we used to go to the committee room and help. And the only way in which I could help was run between the committee room and the polling station to get the lists of the numbers of people who'd voted and go and check them off. And I remember, it seems so strange to me now. You know, it was quite a thrill for those of us working in the committee room when the candidate, Victor Warrender, then the member of parliament, came round and talked to us. And, of course, it never occurred to me that I'd be in the same position.
Mm-hmm. You felt the excitement even then?
I felt the excitement, yes.
Record number 3, what next?
I'm going to something completely different. We love going to opera. It is one of my great relaxations I can't get very often. And I love the choral work, and I love ceremonial.
Triumphal March from Verdi's Aida, from a recording conducted by Zubin Mehta. Now, as a schoolgirl, what were your ambitions, Mrs. Thatcher? Why had you set your heart on going up to Oxford?
I had some very strange ambitions. In my church life, I well remember missionaries coming and talking to us of their experience. And I remember that in the early days, I wanted to go into the Indian Civil Service, because there was a tremendous desire to serve. And I knew that to do that, you had to go to university. But quite apart from that, you know, the opportunity to go to university was to us a chance almost undreamed of. My father had never done it, and I was lucky. I was quite good at school. And so it was assumed that I would try to go to university. The subject was clearly marked out for me, and so it just seemed perfectly natural. And what was there? Oxford or Cambridge were to me worlds that I'd heard about. And it's always a good thing to aim for the top, and I did.
So, a scholarship to Somerville College. And you read chemistry, and what was your first job when you came down?
My first job was in a factory making plastics, and it was in the development section. We were developing new plastics, taking them through the pilot stage, and then thinking what they could be used for and where they could be sold. Sometimes I teased some of my Labour Members of Parliament, friends, and say, you know, I've had more experience of working in a factory than you have.
You went to work for Lyons afterwards?
Afterwards, yes. That was food processing and food processing and control. And I also did quite a bit of research work there into what's called surface chemistry.
You had a nagging ambition to take a law degree. How does law tie up with chemistry?
I went about a lot with my father, as you probably know. And when he went to sit on the magistrate's bench, I used to go along in the school holidays with him. And I met there a person who was a chairman of the bench, a silk, they were KCs in those days, QCs now, who was a lawyer. The chairman of the bench had to be a lawyer. And I talked to him and realized that law itself was having a very great fascination for me. And I remember at the age of 17 saying to him, but you see, I'm already on the science side. And I can't change now. And he said, but don't worry, I took a physics degree at Cambridge. I started that way. And he said, the thing to do, finish your chemistry degree and then do law. You won't be able to afford just to do another degree, but work at it in your own spare time. Because you'll find there's a whole branch of law for which you need both, a science degree and a law degree. And that's the branch of law dealing with patents.
Well, a lot was to happen before you were called to the bar. Before we talk about all that, let's have another record. What's next?
What's next? Well, I just cannot live without some humour there, and I love dry humour. Now, there's a marvellous record. It's the imagination of what happened had Walter Raleigh been able to ring up and announce that he'd made a discovery of tobacco. It's Bob Newhart.
Like, what are some of the uses, Bob? Are you saying snuff, Walt? What's snuff? You take a pinch of tobacco. And you shove it up your nose. And it makes you sneeze, huh?
Bob Newhart and Nutty Walt. At the age of only 24, I think, you agreed to contest an absolutely hopeless seat at Dartford. In fact, you contested it twice. Did you enjoy those rather hopeless hustings?
Yes, but you see, to me, they weren't hopeless. There'd been a tremendous political swing in 1945, and nothing was impossible. We hoped for a tremendous swing back. I don't think we could quite have turned a 20,000 Labour majority into a Tory seat, but one was young and full of hope. But I loved it. We had meetings outside factories. We went round canvassing. And, you know, in tough seats, and I'm sure both political parties find that, you get the most marvellous band of helpers, really believing fervently in the cause, and you get a tremendous bond of friendship. It taught me a lot.
Well, one of those helpers, one of the supporters of Miss Margaret Roberts, as you were, was a Major Dennis Thatcher, who was managing director of a paint firm. Do you remember the very first time you met him?
I do, because it was the night that I was adopted as candidate, and I had to get back to London, and I spoke to the meeting, and it was thought that I obviously must circulate afterwards to get to know as many people as possible, and I'd miss the last train. So he was approached. Would he like to drive me back to London? Mercifully, he did like, and so eventually did I.
And how long afterwards were you married?
Not until, that was 1949. Not until 1951.
Now, 2 years later, you took your bar intermediate in May, produced twins in August, and took your bar finals in December. That was an action-packed 8 months, wasn't it?
Yes, it was, wasn't it? I had the children in August. I had them the day we won the Ashes. Do I remember? It was a Saturday. We couldn't find my husband. They took rather a long time to arrive, and he'd sort of mooched off somewhere. And I think within 2 or 3 days, I had decided that if I didn't do something quite definite, that I would be in danger of never returning to work again. And so I entered my name for the bar finals. Once I'd done that, I knew pride would make me work and that I'd just have to get them.
Yes. How long did you practice law?
6 years.
Then in 1959, you began your parliamentary career as member for Finchley. Was that a fairly easy seat?
It was easy in the sense that one pretty well knew what the result was going to be. It had a good Conservative majority. But we worked jolly hard at it, and worked jolly hard to keep it that way.
Yes. Now, within 2 years of entering Parliament, you were appointed to a junior post in the Ministry of Pensions, and you had other front-bent appointments. And then in 1967, you were invited to join the shadow cabinet, and either in government or opposition, you took over power and transport, education and environment. Now, out of your political life so far, out of all the battles and triumphs, which is the coup or the piece of legislation or even just a moment of verbal fencing which you look back on with most pleasure?
I think the time, two bits really. I'm sorry I can't have one, but I must have two. The two most interesting portfolios I found to handle are Treasury, because it's absolutely central to what happens to the whole of the nation. And, apart from education when I was minister, fuel and power. I can remember one bit of verbal fencing. It was the first debate I'd had to do as opposition spokesman on fuel and power. And they were all wondering how this woman would tackle fuel and power. And I had worked like a Trojan. I'd worked at all the facts and figures. And someone got up and cited a whole list of figures as illustrating a certain point. And I was able to say, because I knew exactly the moment he spoke them, exactly which figures they were. Yes, those figures would have proved that point had he quoted the right year. But he had quoted the wrong year. And after that, I was in on fuel and power. It was all right. I knew what I was talking about. As it was a person who was supposed to be really up in these matters, it was definitely a plus.
Another record. What next?
Oh, I think I should go back to the years when I was a young woman. There was some such marvellous music written then. Wonderful lyrics and wonderful music. You know, I don't think Jerome Kern or Cole Porter have ever been beaten. And I think the one that I love most of all is the one called Smoke Gets in Your Eyes.
They said someday you'll find all who love are blind. When your heart's on fire, you must realize smoke gets in your eyes.
Smoke Gets in Your Eyes, Irene Dunne. Now, 1975, a feeling in some quarters of the Conservative Party that it was time for a change in leadership. Was leader of the party a post you had ever envisaged?
Never.
It all happened pretty suddenly. Had you an organised group of supporters? How did you get things going?
No, I hadn't an organised group of supporters. at all. Some of them came to me and said, look, if you'll stand, we'll back you. And that was really... So I knew that I had quite a bit of backing. But it all really happened rather suddenly. It was quite clear that there was going to be an election for the leadership. And then it looked as if no one would put up for the leadership. And I remember very vividly saying, well, if no one else will do it, I will. And the moment I said it, I never had a moment's hesitation about it. I knew it was absolutely the right thing to do. I wasn't worried that I'd said it. I wasn't worried that I'd made the decision. The decision was made. And then we just had to do the best we could and take what came.
Well, you're the first woman to become leader of a major British political party. How many women are there in the House now?
Oh, compared to a few, we haven't got more than about 25 or 26.
Is the number going up?
No, it hasn't changed since the 30s. It's absurd when you think the number of women who have a really good training, so many more of them ought to come forward to offer themselves as candidates.
It's time we had another record.
Well, I'm going to take again another record which reminds me very much of my childhood. In our church, we performed a lot of oratorios. We had a very good choir. We hadn't, of course, the lead soloists. We always had to get those down from London, and it was a great occasion. And I, therefore, have chosen an oratorio record. This time, one from Elijah, Be Not Afraid, Thy Help Is Near.
Be Not Afraid, Your Help Is Near, from Mendelssohn's Elijah, Gwyneth Jones as soloist, in a recording conducted by Frubeck de Burgos. Now, it's occurred to me, Mrs. Thatcher, that you must already have had to face some problems because of your sex. They must have had to bend the rules a bit when you joined the Carlton Club.
They were very sweet about it. I didn't join the Carlton Club as a woman. They said the leader of the party has always been a member of the Carlton Club. And I don't think they recognise my sex.
The ladies in the Carlton Club aren't allowed on the staircase, but presumably the leader of the Conservative Party is.
Oh, I think they've relaxed that a little. It's such a beautiful staircase that we all wanted to go up it when there were receptions there. It's a lovely staircase, so we all go up it now.
Now, of course, you know number 10 Downing Street very well. Does it appeal to you as a place to live in?
It's not a home. It's very much a residence. You know the difference.
Yes.
And I've always thought that some of the decorations there have a slightly heavy touch. But one can't just redecorate it. One might make one or two changes, but they wouldn't be expensive changes.
Record number 7.
Record number 7 is one that my son introduced me to. He's very keen on acquiring as many records and as many tapes as possible. And if I go home in the evening, and I always call out anyone at home, and nothing answers me but some music comes from the bathroom, well, I know he's in. But recently, just before Christmas, he came home with this one. And I think it's one of the most haunting records I've heard.
Andante for trumpet, composed and directed by Saint-Preux. Now, your last record, what's that?
Oh, we must finish, I think, on a high note, and preferably one with something rather more than earthly qualities about it. Let's have that wonderful record, the Easter hymn from Cavalera Rusticana.
Easter hymn from Cavalleria Rusticana, the chorus and orchestra of the Royal Opera House Covent Garden, conducted by Lamberto Gardelli. If you could choose only one of your eight records, which would it be?
Oh, it would undoubtedly be the Emperor Concerto. It has so many varying moods.
And you're allowed to take one luxury with you to the island, any one thing of no practical use.
I thought about this a lot. And I decided the thing I would like most of all would be a photograph album of the children. We had some wonderful photographs, and I would only have memories and hopes to live on.
And one book, apart from the Bible and Shakespeare, and we don't allow big encyclopedias.
Oh, no. Well, I think if we had the Bible and Shakespeare, I'd be having enough intellectual and philosophical exercise. So I should turn to something practical. And I found a book. It's called The Survival Handbook. Self-sufficiency for everyone. And it even tells you how to make a boat. It tells you how to weave. It tells you how to cook all sorts of things, about making long bows and arrows. Don't you think that would just be right?
Ah, it's a book that no castaway should be without. Who compiled it?
It's compiled by a person called Michael Allaby, with a number of other people.
The Survival Handbook. And thank you, Mrs. Thatcher, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
I've loved it. Thank you very much.
Goodbye, everyone.
You've been listening to a podcast from the Desert Island Discs archive. For more podcasts, please visit bbc.co.uk/radio4.